Marie Curie's discoveries in radiation changed the world. She became one of the most important women in science, and her research is still important to scientists and doctors today. She became the first person, male or female, to win the Nobel Prize twice. And Marie's discovery of the element radium helped unlock the mysteries of the atom. Yet she came from the most unlikely of circumstances. Marie Curie showed us that through hard work and determination, anything is possible. So, in this week's Biographics, we meet Marie Curie, scientific pioneer. It was like a new world opened up to me, the world of science. Maria Salome Sklodowska was born on November 7, 1867, in Warsaw, Poland. She was the fifth child born to Władysław and Bronisława Sklodowska, who were both teachers. Władysław taught high school physics and mathematics, and although Bronisława gave birth to five children in 8 years and had tuberculosis, she was the full-time director of a private school for girls. It was only after the birth of Maria that she finally retired. Through a series of bad investments, the family had unfortunately lost their savings, requiring them to board at the private school where Bronisława had taught. This meant that for the children, there was no privacy, and they had to keep quiet and on their best behavior at all times. As I just mentioned, Bronisława suffered from tuberculosis. She was terrified of passing the lung disease on to her children, so she refused to hug them or show any physical affection. When Maria, who was known as Mania, was around 5, the family managed to get a place of their own, but they had to take in boarders in order to make ends meet. Mania didn't have her own bedroom, but had to sleep on the sofa in the dining room. As part of her chores, she had to get up early in order to set the table for breakfast. Mania was fascinated with the instruments that her father, who was a teacher of physics, kept in his little study, especially the electroscope. When she started school in 1874, aged 6, she was the youngest and the smallest child there. However, she soon proved herself to be among the smartest of the students in her class. She had an excellent memory, so she was often selected to recite poetry for visitors. This was something that the intensely shy girl absolutely detested. Life in Poland was tough during the latter half of the 19th century. Warsaw was under Russian rule. Law forbade the speaking of Polish or the learning of any Polish history. However, these laws totally backfired, causing many Poles, including Mania's family, to be even more proud of their Polish heritage. Mania dreamed of doing great things and bringing honor to their country. When Mania was just 8 years old, her older sister, Zofia, caught typhus and died. About 2 years later, Mania's mother, she died from tuberculosis. The little girl was inconsolable. The two dearest people in her life, her sister and her mother, had been cruelly snatched away from her. Despite her despair, Mania was able to maintain top grades at school. With the love and support of her father and remaining siblings, she began to dream about an accomplished future. In 1883, she completed her high school education. She was the first in her class in every single subject. Shortly thereafter, though, she became ill with what was called fatigue of growth and study. She spent a year recovering with her relatives in the country. On her return, Mania was intent on furthering her education in the sciences, but the Russian government forbade any Polish woman from attending the University of Warsaw. Mania made a pact with her older sister Bronia. They would pool their finances so that first Bronia and then Mania could attend the University of Paris. Mania spent the next 6 years as governess, which meant that she was little more than a servant to a wealthy family. For 3.5 of those years, she lived with the Zarowski family, 60 miles from Warsaw. She tutored the children 7 hours a day and was in the beck and call of the remainder of the family at all times. With the father's approval, she also taught local peasant children to read and write, an illegal activity for which she could have been severely punished. She used every moment of her precious free time in order to study. During this time, Mania also began attending secret meetings of the floating university. Members read about scientific and other works that were banned by the Russians because they thought that they might stir up rebellious ideas. After a year of living with the Zarowski family, Mania met their oldest son, who was home from university. He and Mania, now aged 19, quickly fell in love. However, the Zarowskis refused to let their son marry a poor governess. The unhappy couple separated, but Mania kept working for the family because Bronia was depending on her in order to pay her way. To get over the heartbreak, Mania threw herself into her studies. She focused on physics and chemistry. In 1889, her employments with the Zarowskis ended, and she moved back to Warsaw, where she began working for another family. One of her cousins ran Warsaw's Museum of Industry and Agriculture, which was a lab where Polish students, including Mania, could study science. By 1891, Marie had saved enough money for her to join Brogne in Paris, and it was here that she actually changed her name to Marie, the French version of her name. Living with Brogne and her new husband, Marie attended the Sorbonne University. Before long, she tired of the commute and moved into the student area, living in a tiny attic with no proper lighting and only a coal stove. She had very little money, ate poorly, and had to pay for her lessons, and worked long hours in the university library to do so. Yet, she found her work so satisfying that the hardships, they were worth it to her. Marie had to work much harder than her classmates due to her limited understanding of the French language. Still, she graduated in 1893, having earned a master's degree in physics. She also got the top marks in her class. In addition, she won a scholarship which allowed her to begin studying for a second degree, this time in mathematics. While studying for her mathematics degree, Marie got a job studying the magnetism of various types of steel for a French company. To do the work, however, she needed to find a lab. A friend introduced her to a man who could help her do so. His name was Pierre Curie, a teacher and head of the lab at the School of Industrial Physics and Chemistry in Paris. He was already famous at this point for his work with crystals and magnets. Marie began doing her investigations on the different types of steel as Pierre continued researching the effect of electricity on crystals. No one was more surprised than Curie herself when he became attracted to Marie. This man of science considered most women to be a waste of space, yet Marie, she was different. She was brilliant and had a deep love for science. Instead of wooing her with flowers, Pierre attempted to steal Marie's heart by giving her an autographed copy of one of his physics papers. Pierre asked Marie to marry him shortly after they met. Marie wanted to say yes, but felt that if she did marry Pierre, she would never again live in her beloved Poland. After completing her mathematics degree, she returned to Warsaw for a holiday, unsure if she would ever go back to Paris. However, she was bombarded with love letters from Pierre. She finally decided to return in order to continue her education and to see Pierre. Marie and Pierre were married on July 26, 1895. The ever-practical Marie wore a dark blue suit that she could later wear in the lab. For the next year, she worked in Pierre's lab studying steel and magnetism. In August 1896, she gave birth to Irene, their first child. Becoming a mother, though, it didn't slow her down. She decided to earn a doctorate in physics and needed a new topic to study. She had heard about a French physicist named Henri Becquerel and his discovery of mysterious uranium rays in 1896. The subject fascinated her, and she decided to make it the focus of her doctorate. In November 1893, Wilhelm Röntgen, a German physicist, discovered invisible penetrating rays coming from an electric tube in one of his experiments. He called them X-rays because he just didn't know what they were. They had the ability to pass through flesh and other substances, but not through hard, dense materials like bones and thick metals. X-rays and their effects became world famous within months. In 1896, the French physicist Henri Becquerel discovered more kinds of penetrating rays. Unlike Röntgen's, which were made by an electrical effect, these rays seemed to come naturally from a piece of uranium. Becquerel had left the uranium lying on a sealed packet of photographic paper for several days in a drawer, and it caused the paper to mist over. The uranium seemed to produce some kind of invisible rays that could pass through the thick black paper. Most scientists, they ignored the uranium rays, but not Marie Curie. She threw herself into the study, first systematically searching for uranium-type rays coming from other elements. Checking through all 70 elements, she found that thorium gave off rays. Next, Marie analyzed rocks that contained more than one element. As she expected, most of the uranium-type rays were given off by the rocks called pitchblende. This was because they contained uranium or thorium. But to her surprise, pitchblende gave off more radiation than she expected. And the question then came to mind, well, what was causing this extra radiation? After checking her results more than 20 times, Marie announced in July of 1898 that she had found a new element. She named it polonium, after her beloved Poland. At the same time, she invented the word radioactive to describe polonium, uranium, and thorium. Then, in December of 1898, Marie announced the discovery of another new and even more radioactive element, radium. But this was just the beginning, because years of work lay ahead. Marie and Pierre had to prove to fellow scientists that polonium and radium existed, and to do this, they had to produce the two elements in their purest forms, find the weight of the atoms, and show that each element has an atomic weight different from any other element. But their first focus, it was to produce pure radium. To do this, they needed two things: lots of pitchblende and a large lab. The pitch blend came from a mine in Austria, and the Curies were able to buy it up very cheaply. Finding lab space, though, that was harder. The only room available was a cold, leaky shed near Pierre's work, but it gave them the source that they needed. Marie had to melt pitch blend in huge pots and stir it with a steel rod almost as tall as he was. Despite the hard work, she was determined to discover everything she could about radioactivity. Between 1900 and 1903, Marie published many papers on her work. During this period, she was also completing her doctoral degree and trying to produce pure radium. As if that was not enough, in 1900 she began teaching at a teacher's college in Sèvres, a Parisian suburb. And, of course, she was raising her daughter, Irene. On July 21, 1902, Marie finally reported the weight of one radium atom. This was a major breakthrough. Because the weight of the radium atom was different from the atomic weight of any other element, it proved that Marie had indeed discovered a new element. Marie and Pierre could have become rich by claiming all rights to working with radium. Instead, they shared their information, telling people how they'd purified the element and much more. They believed scientific research should benefit everybody. In 1903, Marie became the first woman in Europe to receive a doctorate in science. But as the fame of the uber-science couple grew, their physical health began to deteriorate. Pierre was constantly tired and in pain, and Marie was also in a constant state of exhaustion. She had recently had a miscarriage and had lost a lot of weight. They both also suffered from burnt, numb fingertips. We now know that they were suffering from the effects of radiation exposure. At the time, radium was being touted for its health benefits. Because it could kill healthy tissue, doctors tested it on diseased cells and found that it also destroyed them. Soon, radium was being used to stop cancer cells from growing in patients with cancer. The new treatment, it was called Curie therapy. In November 1903, Marie and Pierre were given the Humphrey Davy Medal, England's highest award in chemistry. But the greatest accolade, that came a month later, when they, along with Henri Becquerel, won the Nobel Prize for Physics. The Nobel Prize came with a substantial cash award. This allowed the Curies, for the first time, to hire a lab assistant. Now, reporters and visitors, they wanted to meet the famous scientific couple. Some eager reporters even attempted to interview the Curies' young daughter, Irene. Nobel Prize winners had to travel to Sweden to receive their award and speak about their work, but Marie was too ill to go. It wasn't until 1905 that she was able to make the trip. The couple's feelings about the prize, though, they were mixed. Marie was proud of her work and her accomplishment of being the first woman to achieve world fame as a scientist. The prize money also helped to fund their research, which they had so far been paying for out of their own pocket. But they disliked the fame that came along with the award, feeling that it interfered with their work. Then, in 1904, Marie gave birth to a second daughter, Eve. Shortly thereafter, Pierre was made a professor at the Sorbonne. He was given a better laboratory, and Marie was paid as his chief assistant. The next year, he was elected to the Academy of Sciences. For 2 years, things went well for the Curies. They were finally comfortable financially and were respected leaders in their field. Then, in April 1906, tragedy struck. They had just enjoyed a relaxed weekend in the country and were back in rainy Paris. A rushed off his feet, Pierre was running errands in the rain when he stepped out across the road and fell in front of a horse-drawn wagon. The startled horse reared up and its hooves missed Pierre, but the rear wheels crushed his skull, killing him instantly. When word spread that a famous scientist had been killed, the crowd had to be stopped from attacking the innocent driver. Marie didn't hear about the tragedy until she returned home that night. She was simply devastated by her husband's death. However, she remembered what he had once told her. Whatever happens, even if one should become like a body without a soul, still, one must work. So when she was offered her husband's job at the Sorbonne, she accepted. Before her first class, reporters, students, and curious people crowded the hall to see the first female teacher at the Institute. They wondered if she would praise her husband or break down under the strain. Instead, she began quietly speaking, picking up at the very spot where Pierre had left off during his last lecture. One of Marie's deepest regrets was that Pierre had died without ever having his own permanent lab. It gave her great satisfaction in 1909 when plans were put in place to establish the Radium Institute in Paris. It would have a laboratory that Marie would supervise, and it would be known as the Curie Pavilion. Working as hard as ever, Marie noted that Lord Kelvin, a Scottish physicist, had suggested that radium was not an element since it had been found to give off helium gas, which is itself an element. She continued to make even purer polonium and radium. By 1910, she had produced pure radium and showed that it was a brilliant white metal. She even found its melting point, which was 700 degrees Celsius. In 1910, Marie also published her 971-page work, Treatise on Radioactivity. And in 1911 came another great honor, the Nobel Prize for Chemistry, which was awarded to her alone for making pure radium. In 1911, Radiology Congress, an international group of radiation scientists, decided they needed a new unit of measurement for radiation, and they called it the Curie. Marie insisted that she was the only one who could take on the task of working out the exact size of a Curie unit. It was painstaking work, but she did it all in Pierre's honor. In 1911, Marie failed to be elected to the French Academy of Sciences. Many people said that it was simply because she was a woman. Her scientific work, it was of the highest quality. By this point, her personal life was being followed closely by the newspapers, and there was great interest in her friendship with physicist colleague Paul Langevin. Extremely upset by all this attention, Marie fell ill. After treatment, she stayed with her friend, Hertha Arten, in England. By 1914, the Radium Institute at the University of Paris was finished, the same year that World War I began. Marie threw herself into the war effort. She organized X-ray equipment for hospitals to help them locate bullets and shrapnel in the wounds of injured soldiers. She also set up a course to train people in the use of radiography units. At the war's end, in 1918, Marie became director of the Paris Radium Institute. The institute became a world center for radiation physics and chemistry. In 1920, Marie became friends with Marie Maloney, an American journalist. Maloney helped to improve Curie's public image and planned to raise money for the Radium Institute by a lecture tour in the USA. Although her hearing and sight were failing her, she carried out part of the tour before her illness forced her to return to France. Many universities awarded her special degrees, and the Women of America gave her 1 gram of radium worth $100,000. This was in recognition of her work and achievements as a female scientist. In 1922, she was at last elected to the French Academy of Medicine. In the early 1920s, scientists finally realized the dangers of radiation. People working with radioactive material began taking precautions, but it was too late for Marie. Her work with radiation probably caused the cataracts in her eyes that now threatened her with blindness. She had to have 4 operations to remove the cataracts, but wanted no one to know. She didn't want people thinking she was old and helpless. Marie continued to oversee the work in her own labs in Paris. She also traveled to raise funds for research by younger scientists. In 1928, she had a final operation for her cataracts. She was then cared for by her daughter Eve. After further illness, she died on July 4, 1934, in Switzerland. She died of aplastic anemia, a lack of red blood cells caused by extended exposure to radiation. Marie's legacy, it lived on in her daughter Irene. In 1935, her and her husband Frederick received the Nobel Prize for Chemistry. In 1995, Marie and Pierre were reburied in the Pantheon in Paris. She is the first woman given that honor based on her own achievements. So I really hope you enjoyed that episode of Biographics. If you did, there's a couple of things you could do right now. One is hit that like button below. Also, if you want more stuff like this, we put out brand new videos every Monday and every Thursday. So hit that subscribe button below. And subscribe button doesn't do what it used to on YouTube. If you actually want to get a notification about these videos, please do hit that bell button next to the subscribe button, and that'll send you a notification every time, every Monday and Thursday, when we put out a new video. Also, if you want to watch something else right now, stuff from the archive, over there on the right. And as always, thank you for watching.